here on the Greg Banks Show worldwide and also locally on the airnetwork.net. Glad to have you along. 94.1 FM in Huntingdon. And as we approach the studio this morning, as always, coming up with some topics of discussion. People, of course, asking us if there are certain things going on in the world today that they are intensely amazed at. And, of course, we'll talk about some of those things, but more importantly, things close to home here in Huntingdon and, of course, Huntingdon County. Speaking of which, the Firemen's Convention underway in Petersburg this week. You know what? I have a phone number here. Maybe we'll call this morning. And as we're dabbling around the studio, of course, checking our email. You know, I get to the office late every morning. It's just down the hallway from my bedroom. Oh, there's a lot to be done before I even get to the studio. We designed it so that we would do a little talk show every day about this time, live, 9 to 10. And, of course, rebroadcast 4 to 5 on the Air Network. And talk a little bit about my hometown and what's happening in our area. And, there's a really cool article in the Altoona Mirror this morning. Go online, check that out. Those of you familiar with Stonetown Gallery and Cafe will be enlightened. Yeah, I never knew the whole story about how they started down there, Deb and Carolyn. What a beautiful place. And not only that, interesting place, but the food is great. And so I concur that, according to the article, it is the place to be if you're coming into downtown Huntingdon on Washington Street, Stonetown Gallery and Cafe. That's what we do. We promote things happening in our hometown. And matter of fact, I can probably bring Carolyn and Deb on the show someday. Or I'll stop by the cafe there and talk with them a little bit, record it. And we've even given us some thought, because we've talked among ourselves, that we would do a show down there live from their location at some given time. It's just a matter of finding some time. You know how that works, right? All right. So meanwhile, we were talking about the Firemen's Convention underway in Petersburg. And it's happening at the Petersburg Fire Hall. Basically, that's the central location for the Firemen's Convention. So if you stop there, get a list of the activities. Don't call the fire hall. They're going to be busy this week as it is, welcoming all the firemen and fire ladies from around the Huntingdon County area. It's a spectacle to behold. It's one of those things that you got to be a part of. If you've never been to a Firemen's Convention, you don't know what you're missing. Going to be a half-decent day for it, somewhat cloudy. Showers are likely with an afternoon shower. Expect this. Some of the storms, by the way, could produce small hail and gusty winds. High today near 87. Then tonight, a chance of showers cooling down to about 70. And I don't know, what would be the average temperature around here for, let's say, July? You know, Stevie Wonder did an album called, Hotter Than July. Well, guess what? You stick around long enough, let's say August. Oh, hell, we're going to have some hot days in August, too. It'll be a hot time in town as the temperatures begin to increase just a bit. I think I could live with, temperatures year-round in, let's say, the low to mid-70s. I could deal with that. You know, a little bit of rain. Talk to my friend Butch, who was my neighbor for 30 years in Johnstown. He's kind of watching the homestead for me as we decide what to do with our previous house, or a former house residence, if you will, up in the woods. He and I were the only neighbors there. Kind of interesting dichotomy and relationship for 30 years. Interesting guy who would come up on his lawn tractor 9 o'clock in the morning holding a beer. Oh, yeah, he was probably cutting grass somewhere, but he had that lawn tractor. It's like many of you guys in this area who have those golf carts. Well, that's how he traveled. Through the acreage, if you will. And he'd bring a beer up around 9 o'clock and say, "You want one?" It's like, dude, who is drinking a beer at 9 o'clock? Only to my amazement, you know, the first time I met him 30 years ago, I had to wonder, oh, is this really the neighborhood I want to live in? Do I want to be isolated up here on top of this mountain with this? I mean, he was truly a mountain man. Great neighbor, 30 years. Basically went fishing, hung out together. He did gardening. Just crazy stuff. Raised his children. They were crazy, too. Now they've got crazy grandchildren. But it's kind of interesting relationship. And I kind of miss him. So we were talking the other day just to see how he's doing. Saying, "How's the house doing?" He goes, "I don't know. It's still there." He said, "But I can take care of that for you." "Oh, no. He said, "Come on home." I said, "I am home. I'm where it all began in Huntingdon, Pennsylvania. You know, once you're born here, you pretty much you never leave here. Although you may go somewhere and live, you know, physically for 30, 40 years, but you always want to try to get back home. So that's how we roll here on the airnetwork.net, on the Greg Banks Show. Poncho, you remember me, or you don't. You know, there's a lot of people that have moved into Huntingdon in 40 years. Oh, yeah, some of these people, you know, they were moving from town to town. Maybe I met a couple who had a connection with Juniata College. Their daughter graduated at Juniata College. They came for a weekend, and they stayed for a lifetime. No, seriously, they loved our town so much, they just showed up. And they stayed here. And they were from Jersey. I think they were from Trenton or somewhere in that area. Well, you can only imagine. Hell, you're in Trenton. Come on now. It's like comparing apples and oranges. Oh, I might stay in Trenton. I might come to Huntingdon. Ah, well, they made the greatest choice. So we say to them, welcome. And oh, welcome to all the other folks who moved into our little town and our area. One of the coolest towns in America, Huntingdon, Pennsylvania. All right, I can do nothing but really just promote all day, but I don't have time to do that. There are things to get on with. We told you about the forecast. Did I tell you about some of the things coming up in town? Okay, well, there are a lot of activities. And so throughout the course of this week and throughout the course of the next months to come on the show here, live, 9 to 10, Monday through Friday, rebroadcast 4 to 5, because some people are getting that really mistaken that we're on from 4 to 5. It sounds like we're live, but actually it's a rebroadcast, and we continue to give out our phone number, which, by the way, is 814-506-0609. That's 814-506-0609. If you have something to share with our audience or you have an upcoming event, we'd love to hear from you. If you don't have time to pick up the phone, well, you can always email us. You can send that email to gbanks9170@comcast.net. That's gbanks9170@comcast.net. Oh, here's something cool. Yesterday, out around Seward, now that's just west of Johnstown, probably about 20 miles, there's an area out there called New Florence, Seward, just down Hawes Pike, as we recalled, outside of Johnstown. Dana Heinze, who has been in the hockey game for many years, Dana's probably in his early 50s, I imagine, now. But a trainer for the Pittsburgh Penguins got a chance to bring the Stanley Cup home yesterday. Can you imagine? Every player, every coach, every trainer, every administrator with the Pittsburgh Penguins gets one day with the Stanley Cup. So Dana Heinze brings the cup home yesterday. I wish I would have known this, but I wasn't among his throngs of friends, because Dana's traveled quite a bit extensively. I'll tell you the story in a minute. But anyhow, Dana brings home the cup yesterday. Everybody takes pictures with the cup out in Seward yesterday. He has a special party for that. Mrs. Ty was there, Jimmy's mom. Jimmy's with us on the Air Network. He does Monday Night Sports Talk. Oh, there are a lot of my friends that were there getting pictures with the cup yesterday. One couple had a baby. Okay, just recently. That baby's like, maybe 6 weeks old. They stuck the baby in the cup and got a picture of the baby in the Stanley Cup. Now, can you imagine 30 years from now, that baby will be, 30 years older, and watch the pictures and look at those pictures, reminiscing with maybe her children of the day that she was placed inside the Stanley Cup, and her parents are gloating in that picture. And then there was another guy who made a proposal in front of the cup with his girlfriend. He asked for her hand in marriage. And then people kissed the cup. You know, a lot of things are done with this Stanley Cup. I could only imagine. I'm not going to repeat what I've heard, but I know that there are some interesting things over the years in the history of the Stanley Cup that have caused it to be bruised, beaten, scratched. I mean, you can imagine they probably have a couple of cups, probably one on display in the Hockey Hall of Fame, but the traveling cup that Dana Heinze had yesterday, and Dana, by the way, is a trainer for the Pittsburgh Penguins. This is the fourth time that Dana has brought the cup home. I know you're doing the math and you're saying, listen, Greg, the Penguins haven't won the cup four times. Well, dig this. Dana had the opportunity to be also the trainer of the Tampa Bay Lightning. And if you go back in history, the last few years, he was working for them when they won the cup. So he was able to bring the cup home when the Bay Lightnings won the Stanley Cup. Is that amazing or what? Now, Chris Stewart, another Johnstown native, also a member of the Pittsburgh Penguins, on the training staff with Dana Heinze, gets his day with the cup as well. So the Stewart family, living there in Hornerstown, where I used to have a big grocery store and also apartments, used to come to the store as kids all the time, getting their candy and their burgers and stuff. Chris will have it now at his home for a day. So that Stanley Cup is making its way around. And I was saying that maybe, oh, if we were lucky enough, we could have made the connection and got the cup to come to Huntington. Maybe one of the guys would do that. But I understand. It's like if we had somebody working for, let's say, the Pittsburgh Steelers next time they win the Super Bowl. Although they don't let the Super Bowl, you know, they don't travel around with that thing. That's a little bit different. But maybe somebody could be working with the Pittsburgh Penguins in the front office from Huntington. Well, I would hope that next time they win the Stanley Cup, you would bring it home to Huntington and share the excitement with all the people here in our hometown. Wouldn't that be so cool? Yeah, so that's how it goes down. We were talking yesterday also on the Air Network here about the upcoming Steelers season. And, you know, that's always an exciting time. It's almost like a religious thing. Matter of fact, it is somewhat religious because how many ministers do we know understand that on any given Steelers Sunday, dude, cut the sermon short. Or at least, you know, you get to walk up until and maybe do a little sermon up until about maybe 12:30. And then you're going to be doing it with yourself and the organist or maybe the pianist. The only three people left in the church, especially in Western Pennsylvania, in the Pittsburgh-Johnstown area. I'm telling you, I've gone to church services before, and the place is vacant at 12:30. Oh, no, nobody misses kickoff. And so now the priests, the ministers, and the pastors of local and area churches understand on Sundays. And, yeah, it is important that you get the religious understanding and, of course, practices in. But you have to get them in a sort of like a normal time element on Sunday, especially when the Steelers are playing. And that's a given. How many people have gone to their graves, seriously, that we know, uncles, aunts, grandfathers, grandmothers who were Steeler fans? Seriously. And I know going to a lot of services, people that were dressed out in their finery, their Steeler uniforms. We all got to go sometime. But you want to go proudly, huh? You want to say, well, anyhow, so the Steelers are opening up camp the end of July. So we're heading down to camp. We'll do some interviews. We'll talk with some people. We're going to meet up with some old friends. Ike Taylor played for the Steelers for 12 seasons. He's now with the NFL Network. He's also a part of what we do here at the Air Network worldwide. So we'll hook up with he, along with John Harris, the prolific sports writer for ESPN, Sports Illustrated, and all the other periodicals, and get together, kibitz a little bit. I'm sure they're going to want to be doing some business, which I'm really, truly against doing business while we're sitting in Latrobe trying to figure out who's going to make the team this year. No, seriously. And I want to look at some of these young rookies that are coming in. You know, because quite honestly, some of these guys are not going to make it. They just, well, you know what? Every year, we're hopeful when we do the draft. And there are those rounds that you don't even know, and those free agents that are coming in. And quite honestly, we know who the real players are on the Steelers. And chances are, they're not going to be doing a lot of training games. You know, they're not going to be in scrimmages. We don't want a whole bunch of people hurt. Ben's not going to be playing a lot of those games. So July 29th on that Saturday, we head down to Latrobe. I understand we're going to be hanging out for a couple of days, meetings, dinners, receptions, and also what? Go on down to the scrimmages. But having said that, as we move forward, and you know, summer's not even over yet. The All-Star game was last night. And I was tuning in and out. I was looking at, I wanted to see Aaron Judge hit another home run. You know, he won the home run derby the night before. What, hit 45 home runs or something like that? So I wanted to tune in and catch him hitting a home run, which he didn't do. He went 0 for 3, but that's okay. because he kind of burned himself out from the night before hitting all those home runs. And that's okay. He's a rookie. He'll be back again. I watched, Bryce Jordan. Is that who it was? Yeah, I have to go back here and remember who these people were because I don't watch a lot of Major League Baseball. Hell, I'm just kind of trying to get caught up on who the Pirates have on their team now. Sterling Marte, he's coming back. McCutcheon's still there. They tell me he's going to stay in center field even when Marte comes back. I know Josh Harrison was the only one from the Pirates on the All-Star game last night. I didn't see him. But I say that only because there's a different excitement between the Pirates and the Steelers. You can only imagine. No, seriously, you can only imagine. I don't even know what's happening in Pittsburgh right now as far as their baseball team because I kept thinking, quite honestly, that McCutcheon would be somewhat maybe trade bait in the upcoming free agency and the draft after the All-Star game. But I guess he'll still be there, and that might be a good thing. We have a chance.
I got a little change in my pocket going jingle-lang-lang. Wants to call you on the telephone, baby. I give you a ring, but each time we talk, I get the same old thing. Always no hooky-dookies until I get a wedding ring. My honey, my baby, don't put my love up on no shelf. She said, don't give me no lines and keep your hands to yourself.
Friday from 9 to 10 on the air, network.net, and 94.1 FM Huntingdon. Hey, glad to have you along. Kind of a cloudy day. Going to be a muggy one, though. High's about 87 today. As we head into this Wednesday, by the way, our studio lines are open. Maybe you have an event coming up or something you'd like to talk about this morning. We're always open to hearing from you. 814-506-0609. That is 814-506-0609. We don't really worry about having topics of discussion every day, and the reality is I'm in retirement, so I'm kind of like in retirement mode. You know, if I were in that real radio mode, oh, let's say I was under contract making millions of dollars, yeah, in my dream, but no, let's say I was really working, that means that I would put in an extra 2 hours maybe preparing interviews, calling people, saying, hey, Bob, what's going on today? Tell us what's going on in your life. And I got to be quite honest, I'm at the point now, I really don't care. Don't have to, really. But, you know, if you want listeners and you want the ratings and stuff, and we're not doing that play anymore. We don't do that because you do that for 40 years. Oh, you're pretty intense. It brings stress to your life. You know, when you sit in with your producers and the program director and they say, well, you know, your numbers are down a little bit, Greg. We got to do something special and bizarre to get people to listen. Well, see, we're not going to do that. I got to walk among these people. I'm riding my bike and stuff. I'm going fishing and running into people. That'd be like if you're a corrections officer. You're going into work every day. You got to put up with the crap. And then all of a sudden, bada bing, you're fishing on the Juniata River. And you look across the river and you see a guy that looks familiar. And you're like, oh, God, he was in there like for 10 years. I'm out. You know, you don't want to put up with that crap. But anyhow, I had mentioned about the All-Star game last night, tuning in and out. Wanted to see Aaron Judge smack one like 513 feet. The place is under like this big dome there in Miami where the game was held, and the American League won the game 1-0 last night. But I'm waiting for Judge to hit another one, but he was all spent from the night before when he had hit like 45 or 50 home runs in the home run derby. But Bryce Harper, and I think I mentioned Bryce Jordan. Oh, he used to be the president at Penn State, and then they named a building after him. But anyhow, Bryce Harper all had this amazing catch. And one thing I did kind of like last night is they actually mic'd these guys up, out in the field. You know, and as they're waiting for, it's like you being in Little League and you're waiting for somebody to hit one, maybe over the infield out to the left field where you're hanging out. It gets pretty boring and isolated out there after a while. But they have some of these players mic'd up and they're talking to them, while the game's going on. That was intriguing. I'm like, that Fox TV, they come up with some really innovative ways to make a game exciting. Remember the year that Fox got like one of the PGA, the golf tours, and they came up with this special ball that whenever you hit the golf ball, they actually followed it in flight. They had this like tracer following it. The innovation that Fox, of course, has done over the years in sports just amazes me. In hockey, one time they did a hockey game and they put a tracer on the puck so that we could at home watch and follow the puck better. Somebody hit the puck, let's say like Mario Lemieux back in the day, then there was like this little tracing flame that followed the puck so we could kind of see it, because it's hard to see a puck. No, seriously, it is hard to see a puck. So last night they mic'd up these guys, and there was one guy. When they went to him, and I don't know if they were aware, that he had, he had a problem. But it was kind of cool because the guy then said in an interview later, he was proud to be on the broadcast of the All-Star game during the game and being interviewed because he stuttered. The guy has a stuttering problem. That's not funny because I know a lot of people that probably stuttered in their lives. And either they corrected it or they didn't. In this case, a guy has not corrected it yet. But I do know for a fact that he is now the new face of stutterers. Now, I don't know. Do you know any stutterers? I know some people, and it's not really funny, but you want to, like, finish their sentences for them. Back when I was in my, 20s, living in Altoona, the kind of cruel and crude lifestyle, radio guys, you know, I'm talking fluently, and I have one friend, and he used to hang on the streets with us, gang of us, and when he, you know, had something to say, he'd be like, and you wanted to finish his speech, and see, it was probably funny to us back then, but it's not funny now. Now, I'm one of those guys who, quite honestly, back in the, when I was 3 or 4 years old, I didn't talk. I had nothing to say, really. I was one of 7 boys. Well, here's the deal. I remember my dad saying, we took you to the doctors because we thought something was wrong with you. Like, as if I were, like, slow or something. I just didn't have anything to say. And he said, you never said a word from the time you were 1 till you were 3. He said, and then your mom takes you to the doctors and you came back and you haven't stopped talking since. To which I said, I was in my 20s, Dad, but I get paid to talk now. He said, shut up. You're not getting paid here. See, so it is a gift of God. It is a miracle. Maybe this man who was stuttering last night during the All-Star game an all-star player. I think he plays for Minnesota or something, and I don't recall his name, although I could Google it. He still stutters. And so during the game, they let him kind of finish his sentences. He was out there in the field, and they said, well, Bob, how are you doing? And, you know, how's it going tonight? And you had a great hit. And then he see, and it was kind of amazing because I tuned in the middle of a stutter. And now he's known worldwide, and he is the face of stutterers. And that can't be a bad thing. Well, I guess it could be, but he tried to make a point, and the point is, there is help. Oh, it is a problem, and we're going to nip it in the bud, I think. All right, let me do this. Because as I said, it'd be like a kid. You probably have a kid in your house. Boy, maybe he's 35 and he's still living in the basement. That'd be pretty bizarre. It's like he has a paper route. He's 35. He's living in your basement. And I know mothers that have children. They love their children. And it's like they'll do anything for these kids. But I would think at 35, it's time to move on. Oh, we're getting old. We'd love to be empty nesters, but you have decided, though, you're going to hang out in the basement of our house, play video games all day, not look for a job, and you're 35, and heaven forbid you have children. No, I mean, I'm serious. Heaven forbid you procreated somewhere along the line with some girl who is now living in her parents' basement, raising that child of yours. But that's a different story for a different day because, you know what, they have all kinds of reality shows now and nothing amazes me anymore. My brother sits down there, God love him, watching Jerry Springer every day. I got to put up with that right after the news. And so, but that's kind of an interesting thing because my mother always said, take care of your brothers. All right, so I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. All right. Have you heard about the Hobby Lobby thing? Arts and crafts giant Hobby Lobby was pillared last week after it agreed to forfeit $1.6 million worth of smuggled Iraqi antiquities that it bought back in 2010 to promote passion for the Bible. They said they love the Bible. And so they had seen where these terrorists went in and started knocking down statues and stuff in Iraq. Well, it turns out that that wasn't the first time that that company illegally imported artifacts. An attorney for the retailer, Hobby Lobby, confirmed to NBC recently that the $3 million that they'll have to pay the feds to settle that civil case isn't a fine but a payment to cover the unspecified items that were improperly brought to the USA before the 2010 acquisition. Now, isn't Hobby Lobby the people that, they made this big thing about, I don't know, I'm not going back there again, but Hobby Lobby doesn't have those purchases any longer. There was a stipulation outlining the settlement saying that they were dissipated, suggesting that they were either sold or donated. But the company declined to answer questions about the earlier items, including whether any of them were given to the soon-to-open Museum of the Bible in Washington, which Hobby Lobby helped to fund. So they went over there, and, well, they didn't really go over there. On the black market, this stuff was being sold. They went over there, you know, and just basically took all these artifacts. If you remember, they didn't, but the Iraqi war was going on. And people were just like hammering stuff and stealing stuff and taking these great artifacts. And so now there's this cloud over Hobby Lobby. I don't even know if there's a Hobby Lobby store in our area. I've never been to one. I guess if I were into, well, let's say they do hobbies like, oh, remember how when we were kids we built airplanes, model airplanes? If they were one of those stores and I was interested in building model airplane, I'd probably stop by Hobby Lobby. But let's get the real story here. And let's just not kind of gravitate towards the fake news. Let's see if there is a reality to this story.
There are some of the 5,500 Iraqi artifacts that Oklahoma-based Hobby Lobby says it bought to demonstrate its passion for the Bible. The problem? Federal prosecutors say they were smuggled into the U.S., according to the civil complaint, the company bought the items in 2010 from unnamed dealers. Some were misleadingly labeled ceramic tiles. Others were falsely declared as being from Israel and Turkey.
Whenever you have a collector or an institution participating in the black market for antiquities, they are essentially propping up and perpetuating a market from which terrorist organizations can benefit.
The arts and craft chain is perhaps best known for its landmark Supreme Court victory in a 2014 religious freedom case involving contraception. Hobby Lobby says these tablets and clay items were intended not for its retail stores, but for historical preservation. The family that owns the chain has collected 40,000 biblical artifacts and is also helping fund a $500 million Museum of the Bible, slated to open this November in Washington. In a written statement, Hobby Lobby President Steve Green acknowledges, quote, regrettable mistakes that he blames on inexperience. The company also says it did not know the items were from Iraq. We should have exercised more oversight and carefully questioned how the acquisitions were handled, Green says. Tonight, Hobby Lobby has agreed to forfeit the items and pay $3 million to settle the case. Gabe Gutierrez, NBC News, Atlanta.
Well, that's kind of nice to know that they gave all the stuff back and that they are trying to make themselves whole and get back to business as usual at Hobby Lobby. So I wanted to share that story with you. If you have something you'd like to share with us, give us a call. The lines are open. 814-506-0609 is our line. For some reason, I wanted to say calling the love lines because I did a love song show in Johnstown for many years. Popular show, but you can give us a call in our studio lines. 814-506-0609. Tell us something that we don't know. Tell us something about, what's happening in your life. Maybe there's an event coming up. Maybe your church or organization has a special event and we can promote it. You can always email us at gbanks9170@comcast.net. That's gbanks9170@comcast.net. And we'll get your activity on the air and we'll talk about it. Just like, hey, the Moose, the third annual community Moose Splash is coming up for a free day of swimming at the community pool at Isaac Pool in downtown Huntington on Saturday, July 29th. It is free swimming for everybody. By the way, the Moose picking up the cost of that from noon until 7 p.m. Courtesy of the Huntington Moose Family Center 223. The event is open to the public and the Huntington Moose, the heart of the community. So don't forget, it's their third annual Community Moose Splash free swimming from noon until 7 coming up Saturday, July 29th. I wish I could join them, but I'll be at Steeler Camp that day. But I'm sure the show will go on. Now, we were talking about the Moose, and I know there are other organizations. I'm close to the Moose because I decided when I got home last year, I was joining some really prolific organizations like the Moose, Huntington County Drop-In Center. Of course, we had been doing Juneteenth for even 8 years. While I was in Johnstown, I traveled down here, put together the committee, and then pull off this wonderful event known as Juneteenth, the sort of Independence Day for the African Americans in Huntington County. And that was kind of cool. Our 8th year, we just wrapped it up, and then we're heading into year number 9. So we're always active, always doing something, and always looking for groups to get involved with and volunteer and make it happen. Because, you know, in real life, there's only two things that happen. Either you make it happen, or as they used to say, hit happened. Although, hit's not the real word, just add an S to it, okay? So there's wing night every third Friday of the month at the Moose Club. The first Friday of each month, the Huntington Women of the Moose will be serving a dinner special starting at 5 o'clock. Hey, the third Saturday of each month, the Women of the Moose will be serving breakfast at the Lodge starting at 9:30 to 11:30 a.m. And we just told you about the Community Moose Splash coming up on Saturday, July 29th from noon until 7. And here's what's really cool. In August, the 18th through the 20th, the Moose will be hosting the 2017 PMA Moose Riders Rally. Oh, yeah. That's going to be quite cool. Did you ever meet their mascot, Tommy Moose? Well, he stopped by our studios when we were live downtown for Mayfest this year. Quite a interesting person. Don't know who's actually wearing the suit, but I know that if you're in a moose suit, like say today, that's got to be pretty warm. It's got to be actually hot. It's like one of those days like you're like, I'm sorry I signed up for this gig. But whoever that is, hey, God love you. Great job. And our hat's off to the Moose for coming up with something like a novel idea with Tommy the Moose and all the great events that they put together for the fine people of Huntingdon, Pennsylvania. We look forward to telling you more about what's happening at the Moose. And hey, if the Elks, they have something going on, or the VFW, the American Legion, hey, let them know about us. Tell them to email us, and we'll talk about their stuff as well, all right? Hey, I've been following this case with the Penn State frat boys. What you see out of Bellefonte yesterday, the lawyers for members of a Penn State fraternity who faced charges in the death of a pledge spent much of the day in that hearing yesterday focusing on what their clients didn't do the night that Tim Piazza was injured. So a third full day of testimony by the lead detective ended with him still on the stand, and the judge planning two more days next month before he'll decide if there's enough evidence to send the charges to county court for trial. Now, the shuttered Beta Theta Pi chapter and 18 of their members are accused of a range of crimes for their actions related to that February 4th death of 19-year-old Timothy Piazza, a sophomore engineering student from Lebanon, New Jersey. And one by one, because all these kids lawyered up. You can imagine, some of these kids have two, three lawyers. Now, somebody's going to jail. There's no doubt about it. I think what they'd like to happen is that each one of these kids has a separate trial. I don't think that's going to happen. Center County District Attorney Stacy Parks called the defense tactic yesterday basically a circus. She says they're trying to distract attention from what did occur as Piazza suffered a fractured skull, severe abdominal injuries, and bleeding in his brain and stomach. I just wonder now, if this was your child who went off to college, I mean, what's the responsibility here? It's pledge night. It's a fraternity. We know kids like to have fun. But we know when that fun turns tragic like it did on that night on February 4th, you gotta have some responsibility. So who's culpable here? I guess there's enough blame to go around, especially when they tried to cover up what was happening. They saw the kid staggering. They saw him fall down the steps. His head was bobbing. I mean, I don't know. My heart goes out to the family. It doesn't matter what I think. Justice will be doled out probably appropriately, we would hope. I continue to say in America, you know, these kids that get these lawyers, and in this case, I'm sure their parents got probably the finest lawyers. The fact that you even got a trial. No, seriously, you probably know somebody that picked up on some nickel dime charge. Can't afford an attorney. Oh, see, now you got me started here. Can't afford an attorney. And your kid's going to end up doing like 10, 15 years over some dumb stuff that didn't kill anybody. Only because they didn't have a lawyer and there was a plea deal. Because they didn't want to waste time in a court. But in America, you're supposed to be able to waste that time. And oh my God, don't get me started. So, you know, my feeling is I don't know any of these kids. Good luck. If it's the way it should go down. And I've seen things happen in America that are not justified. The only people in court, in jail, was just us. Isn't that what Richard Pryor used to say? Yeah. She is not blind. Oh, no. She's not even colorblind, man, in this instance. I don't think there's a black kid among any of these frat brothers. And they're lawyered up. And you know, man, I could talk for days and days about that. But that comes with experience in life. Oh, it's not always fair. And not always balanced, but who really cares? It's America. We get what we got. Hey, it's Greg Banks Show. We're just hanging out on this Wednesday. Oh, yeah. And I'd love to hear from you. Give me a buzz. 814-506-0609. aernetwork.net. A couple of ways you might want to reach out to us locally, 814-506-0609, if there's something you'd like to talk about, or you can email us, gbanks9170@comcast.net. That's gbanks9170.com. Oh, no, I'm sorry. That's .net, comcast.net. Let me do that again. Okay, here it is, gbanks9170@comcast.net. I'm only laughing because help me on social media as I'm doing this show this morning, and I am amazed at some of the stuff that happens here, man. See, I'm only getting into this Facebook thing. I've not gotten into that Twitter yet, although I did set up an account, but I don't know. Can I say what I need to say? How many characters do they give you? 143. Well, you know, you go on into this rant where you're talking about something that you think is very important, and all of a sudden you run out of letters and characters, and you're like, oh my God, now I gotta like go back and edit this thing to make some sense. And I think that's where America is getting lost. You know, when we think about, okay, our president is using social media, oh, to the fullest extent. He's not even using like press conferences because nobody's talking. Now they're not even showing pictures of these press conferences. You see where we're heading here. Oh, it sort of reminds me of Russia. Things like that happen in Russia. It never happened in America, but now it's happening. Okay, so he doesn't have these press conferences. Nobody's answering any of these questions because they don't really know what the answer is. I'm going to have to talk to the president and get back to you. Meanwhile, he's just tweeting away, you know, but he's very brief in his tweets. He gets to the point. He says what he has to say. And it leaves a lot of questions and leaves like this open-ended, like, okay, so what's that mean? And that's why I don't like Twitter versus Facebook, where you can just put your feelings out there. And sometimes, you know, you can add this emoji. Like, if you're mad, you can click this little face that's, like, all red and, you know, it indicates that you're angry. Or let's say if you love somebody, you can click on this little heart, add that to your post, which means I love you, I guess. And then I'm just learning all the acronyms that come with Facebook after, I guess, they invented this 10 years ago. Before that, my kids were on something called Space, and then it's Facebook, and now they've moved on to Instagram, and we don't even talk anymore as a society. You know, when you call your children down to dinner, this is what's happening in America. You're calling them down to dinner, but you're texting them to let them know it's dinner time. Leave your phones upstairs, kids. This is a very sacred time, dinner time. My God, I took my niece out to dinner one time. Fancy restaurant. She's getting ready to graduate college, and she's on the damn phone. Oh, no. I told her, and I made a scene in this restaurant. I think I was kind of loud. Put the phone away. I'm here. Look at me. Don't text me. I'm right across the table from you. So these kids really, and I shouldn't just blame the kids because now parents have embraced this technology. They could be sitting right there beside you. You ever notice you're in the doctor's office? What are you on your phone for? You're getting ready to have your liver taken out or whatever you're getting ready to do, and you're on the phone. You should be spending that time in prayer because you might not make it through the surgery. I don't know what people were thinking. It's a different time. And I imagine if I'm this confused in my early 60s, somebody who's in their 80s or 90s who has no idea what we're doing. All they're doing is praying to Jesus all the time. No, seriously, you almost have to be prayered up all the time because you never know. But going back to this Washington thing, it's getting to be real interesting. And so I had to get some people off my Facebook page yesterday because, quite honestly, I never invited them to be my friends anyhow. And they just appeared. They're known as trolls. Trolls are people, when you put something out there, they have something to say about everything. Then they want to justify by sending you articles that they've read in National Enquirer or Mad Magazine or something, as if that's a reputable periodical. It's like, my God, you don't have a job. You're sitting at the library using a free internet, and you're tweeting out stuff, and you're on Facebook, and it's like, get a freaking life. No, seriously, get a life. See, at least here, well, with the Air Network, we were so busy doing other things. We've got, oh my God, if I told you what we have coming up nationally and internationally, you'd be like, my God, I thought you were going to retire. Well, I had planned on it, but now I got people making plans for me, and it's like, oh no, thank God people call me first and say, well, listen, I have an idea. Like some of my business associates got an idea. We're working on this new app out here in Colorado, and we don't need to get together with you in a meeting. You don't have to fly out here, thank God, because I'm not flying out there. But we'll get on Skype, and we'll have a conference among like five or six people. We used to do this 10, 15 years ago. Get on Skype. I'm not traveling in the wintertime to Pittsburgh. I'm not traveling to State College for a business meeting. Let's get on Skype. Let's talk about it. Let's get it done. I was in the cable industry. You remember Larry, the cable guy? What was his slogan? The slogan was, get her done. And we got her done. All right, so here's somebody calling in. Thank God on our love lines. Actually, hi, how are you?
Oh, I thought this was a Skype love line.
It is a Skype love line. Hey, listen, we're spreading love this morning. And I'm not even going to ask who this is because I got a feeling I know who it is. And thanks for calling. Finally, hey, let me say, first of all, Steve, I appreciate you, man. Like, how you been doing? I know the Moose is very busy. Do you guys have some event coming up this week? Some ride?
Yeah, we got our Lumatic ride, our 15th year for Lumatic motorcycle ride.
Lumatic motorcycle ride is happening at the Moose. Steve Jackson is on with me. And Steve, are you, you're actually working today too, I guess, huh?
I'm working. Yes, I sure am. Oh. I'm like you. I retired once and then went back to work again.
And why is that we do this, man? I mean, why do we do this kind of stuff to ourselves when we could be out having fun? Although, hey, you're doing a fine job, what you're doing with CART. But let me ask you this. What's that Lumatic ride all about? Tell us about that.
It's just a fun ride. We go visit other clubs and stuff to raise some money for Moose Charities, Moose Heart, local charities. Just a bunch of bikers getting together and doing a little BS, a little fellowship.
Yeah,
okay. Lots of fun.
Okay, and no drinking and driving, though, because you guys are pretty good about that kind of stuff. You don't want people out there drinking and driving. But let me ask you this. When you say various clubs, you mean like clubs in Huntingdon or Huntingdon County? What is that?
Well, Friday night we have our Lumatic Walk. I don't know if you saw that, where we do just walk around Huntington to visit the local clubs, the VFW Legion, some of the local establishments. Saturday's actually a motorcycle ride where we go visit other Moose clubs around the area, outside different towns.
Yeah.
We ride probably a total 100-mile round trip.
Wow, cool. Yeah. Who's that in the background making all that noise back there, Steve? Is that some of the people you're driving around today?
That actually is nobody on. That's why I called you, because I can't have them hear you, because last time they did that, we almost had a riot on the bus here.
Yeah, and I'm not even going back there, because I saw it to my brother yesterday. We were watching the morning news, and anyhow, the lady looks like she's lost a few back there, you know, southeast of Miami. She's kind of tightening it up to North Carolina now, and that's an inside joke, and we're not going to repeat that. But listen, congratulations on all the accolades and the awards that you won out in Chicago recently. I had you on the show with me during the 250th anniversary of the founding of Huntingdon, and we touched on it just briefly, and I know that you're kind of shy when it comes to patting yourself on the back. But what were those awards that you did win in Chicago?
Well, it's just that I received the Pilgrim Award, which is the highest award degree that you can go on the Moose Association.
Cool. Well, I'm sitting here reading some of the things that you guys have coming up. Wing Night, of course, first Friday of each month. The Women of the Moose serving that dinner. Hey, the third annual Community Moose Splash coming up for the third time. This free day of swimming at Isaac's. Do you expect a lot of people down there? That's coming up Saturday, July 29th, eh?
Yeah, and that's really taken off, because I was down there a couple of years ago and was talking to the pool manager and talking things over about this. I was concerned about the families in Huntington have 3, 4, 5 kids.
Oh, yeah.
You really can't afford to send them down that way. And I thought, well, why can't we just rent the pool for a day and then open it up and let them have a swim for the whole day?
That is so fantastic. And you know, we tip our cap to the Moose. I really want to get further involved, and we'll talk about that later. As I've told you, I have some things going up here. But listen, I see here on September the 9th, we'll be having a sock hop with music by Second Edition. Now, what's that all about? Do you remember, do you understand what that's all about? I'm sure you do. You probably
That was actually Dirty's, my wife's idea. She wanted to do a sock hop for the older music and stuff. And I said, well, we'll have to reach back and get one of the older bands, which Second Edition has been around for quite a few years now.
Yeah. And I think I see here online where Reboot's coming back soon. Is that true?
Yeah, Reboot's going to be there Saturday night after their motorcycle ride Saturday. They'll be there to entertain us for a couple hours.
Oh, what a way to wrap up the Saturday, man, with Reboot. That should be a great show in itself. And, of course, hey, listen, when we tell people about what's happening at the Moose, now some of this is open to guests and some of it is just private. How do we know what's open to the public and what's private, by the way?
It's always on there, members and qualified guests. If you know a Moose member, they can bring you in, sign you in, and show you around and tell you all about the Moose, and hopefully you'll join on it, just come in as a guest. Once you're there, you'll probably become a member if you see what it's all about, what we do. All the stuff we do for the community, people don't even hear about it. It's just unbelievable.
Yeah, well, we're going to promote it as much as we can. I'm hanging in there with this show because some days, you know, some days are better than others. We don't always expect to get a phone call, but when we do, especially like from you, we're excited. I wish you'd have called a half an hour ago because I could have had you on for the whole half hour. But I know you got something to do, right?
Us retired folks are busy, Greg.
I know. We need to actually get down and retire someday. But, hey, also thank you for helping out the Bearcat broadcast. We've got Bearcat football coming up in the fall, all 10 games. And because of people like the Moose, 223, that's how we bring it to our folks here in Huntingdon. And we're Bearcats forever, Steve.
I know. And it's a great service that you do for the old Bearcat alumni that's not in the area and like to keep in touch with the sports because, hey, let's face it, the Bearcats are always big in sports.
Yeah,
they can actually hear what's going on, and I think it's fantastic.
All right, we really appreciate all your help. And by the way, we've got Pitt football coming up this fall too, man.
That's right. For all the Penn State fans in that September game, I hate to see what they cried last year. I hate to see them cry again this year.
Hey, and you got something special going on at the Moose that game, don't you? Don't we have a tailgate party or something?
Oh, yeah, we always have a tailgate party. Last year, we had the fifth Penn State tailgate party kind of thinned out after halftime because all the Penn State fans went home.
Went home crying. Oh, no, we're not going to start that. All right, but anyhow, hey, thank you. Thank you, Steve. We'll get together again soon, okay?
Yes, because I got to talk to you about a couple things.
All righty. Well, listen, give me a call on my home line whenever you get a chance. I'll be getting off the air here in about 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay, well, we'll give you a call or we'll look you up. I know where you live.
All right, thank you, sir. I appreciate it. All right, Steve Jackson from the Moose, of course, checking in this morning on the Greg Banks Show. We always appreciate Steve and what the Moose do in the community. And listen, you can always help us out by being a part of what's happening at the Moose. Find out how you can become a member of the Moose today. Stop down at the Moose on Allegheny Street, 223. It's sort of my second home, although I've not been home for a while, and I'm working on it. I keep telling people, man, I get to be, some days I get busy, and yeah, I wish I could retire, but it just doesn't seem to be in the cards. Hey, that wraps up another edition of the Greg Banks Show, albeit short for some reason. These things are getting shorter, but we do have a line that you can call us, just like Steve, at 814-506-0609. We'll be back at it again tomorrow from 9 to 10 live, and of course, listen for the rebroadcast this afternoon from 4 to 5 here on theairnetwork.net. Of course, the pride of Huntingdon and, of course, the Huntingdon Bearcats, it's all right here. Certainly glad to have you along, so thanks for listening.